There's been an endless debate in Alberta. Should energy companies build refineries and upgraders here within the province and upgrade their barrels into diesel and gasoline? Or should they focus on building pipelines, shipping their barrels out to places like Texas where there are larger existing refineries? There are challenges on both sides. Pipelines have stalled. Projects like the Trans Mountain Expansion and Keystone XL to the West Coast and to the US Gulf Coast have met multi-year delays. On the other hand, refineries are extremely expensive. The first new refinery to be built in Alberta in 30 years has seen its costs swell from $5.7 billion to $9.5 billion. So the Sturgeon Refinery has begun producing its first barrels of diesel.
Yeah.
The refinery has come in over budget compared to what was initially estimated.
It has, yeah.
You are hoping to build a second phase of the refinery. How will you be able to keep costs down given how much they escalated for the first phase?
Well, I want to start off by saying I'm happy with what we've done. We worked 40 million man hours in Alberta. I had about 7,500 people at the site. Built the first new refinery since 1984. Pretty well every project like this that has been done has been higher than the budget in the first phase. We're lucky because we conceived it as three identical phases when we started, and so we spent the engineering on phase one. That's all spent now. We did lots of things like pipeline connections, control building, place for the office workers to sit, all that's spent now. We upgraded bridges to get into the area. We built power lines to get into the area, water systems and wastewater systems to get water in and out. And so all those things are built now. And we believe that it's going to be cheaper to build phase two. And something that's really important is we used to live in a gold rush in Alberta, and the gold rush ended. And it's way better to build things after the gold rush than it was during the gold rush. And so phase one has been built during the gold rush.
Is there enough of a spread there between WCS, Western Canada Select, and the diesel that you're producing that people will still be able to make money refining their barrels?
Yeah, so I checked it before I came down here, and so Edmonton diesel to last week averaged about $144 Canadian a barrel, and bitumen averaged about $26 Canadian a barrel, so that's about $118 spread, I think. That is the largest historical spread that has ever been achieved during my lifetime. I'm 68.
So even
there
though
is no better time to build a refinery. And if you think of it, our transportation system is completely full. There's no way to get another barrel of bitumen out except to ship it on a train, which is really expensive, and the trains are getting full now. So these margins are here forever as far as I'm concerned. There's no better time to build things.
Now, at one point, Upgrader Alley, north of Edmonton, there were multiple refineries and upgraders proposed for this area.
Yeah.
I think yours is the only one that
Yeah, I think there were 10 proposed back in the day, and so we're the only one that was really built. These are hard to build. You know, when I came, I was hopeful that we would break the ground and eventually there'd be, if you go to the ship channel in Houston, there's a million barrels a day of heavy processing capacity. And my dream is that there's a million barrels a day of heavy processing capacity in the heartland. And I believe that if we showed the way, others would follow on and they'd see it was possible here and that these are really transformational things that we can put in our economy.
Given that other projects had been scrapped, but at that time there hadn't been these multi-year delays for pipelines, are you feeling like we're in a situation now where companies frustrated with a lack of market access, lack of new pipelines being built, are having another look at ideas like yours?
Well, I think they have to be because, you know, if you look at the oil sands, there's 1.7 trillion barrels of bitumen up there. And we've got about 186 billion barrels of proven reserves. So there's an enormous reservoir up there. Everybody knows it's there, and they know that we can continually been reducing the cost. The question is, how do you get it out? How do you get it away? How do you get it to market? And so far we've been thinking, well, I'll just put it in a pipe and I won't worry about the rest of it. And the pipes are full now, so I have to worry about the pipes, and then I have to worry about the rest of it too, because the next thing after the pipe is a refinery. I need to know what refinery it's going to, because bitumen needs a special kind of refinery. And in the world, there's only 5 million barrels a day of that kind of refining capacity. And we're talking about sending 1 million barrels a day or something off the West Coast. So we need to know, the next step is we need to know, where does that go?
Right.
And then the step after that is bitumen's inherently high CO2. When I make bitumen into fuel, I'm about 20% more CO2 intensive than the average light crude slate in the U.S. We can manage that here because we can capture the CO2 from the refining process and use it for enhanced oil recovery. We can go back to all the oil fields that we found in central Alberta and put CO2 in them, and there's a billion barrels of light oil waiting to come out, and we can put 2 billion tons. If we manage the CO2 we can here, we can be 7% better than the other oil that's made into diesel fuel. The third thing that is really important is there's these regulations called the International Maritime Organization regulations.
I was going to ask about this. Okay. This is another challenge that's coming after some of these pipelines potentially are built.
Yeah.
Once the pipelines are built, then Canadian heavy oil producers will be hit with another problem, which is changes in the way big ships are allowed to burn their fuel.
Big ships floating around in the ocean burn about 3.9 million barrels per day of high sulfur oil right now. They're changing the regulations, just like we did with diesel, 10 years ago here. The trucks can't burn high sulfur diesel anymore. Boats won't be able to burn it. They're going to reduce it from 5% to 0.5%. And when they do that, that 3.9 million barrels that's being burned today is going to have to be refined. Mm-hmm. And when you think of it, that's exactly what bitumen is. It's a high sulfur heavy feedstock, and so it's going to compete for the refining space that we've got. And so there's only 5 million barrels a day of that refining capacity in the whole world. So 3.9 new million barrels is coming from someplace, and it's going to compete with it. And my guess is that that makes our bitumen less valuable. The IMO regulations are a big opportunity for us because we can make the stuff that goes into those boats. So if we get our act together and start making it, we can send the right kind of fuel to those boats. That's what we make here.
There was an IHS market report published at the end of 2017, and it had said that it's cheaper to build a refinery elsewhere. You're suggesting Alberta's the place to build it.
Well, it's probably cheaper to build refineries on Mars, but you have to get bitumen to them. And if I can't get bitumen to the coast, and if I can't, get the shipping arranged to do that, it doesn't matter if it's cheaper in China or not. I can't get the feedstock there. And so we've got bitumen. We can either convert it and export what we make to the 500,000 service stations in the world, or we can send bitumen to one of the 50 refineries that can take it. I vote for the 500,000 service stations, and I don't think bitumen's going to get out of town easily in the future.
So you think these pipeline issues will potentially persist?
I think, I'm hopeful that we get the pipelines that are on the planning approved. But even if we do, there's 1.7 trillion barrels of oil up there. It's going to take 169 years at the current production rate to produce the bitumen we know about that's proven today. And we still got 10 times that amount sitting up there. So I don't think pipelines are getting easier to build. I think they're getting harder. If we get the three that people are talking about, hooray. But there's still lots of opportunity here, and I think we got to take advantage of the opportunity that we were given.
You've been fighting this lonely battle to build refining capacity here. You've taken a lot of flack from economists, from the former finance minister, from reporters like myself. Given that this refinery is starting up at the time that it is, do you feel in some ways like you've been vindicated, but you still have a lot of challenges ahead if you want to build any more refining capacity here, given the prices?
Yeah. There's lots of challenges, but when I started doing this, I looked to the horizon and I said, what's their future going to look like for this place? And I thought, there's more bitumen than there is pipelines. Bitumen's easier to get out of the ground than it is to refine it. I thought it's high CO2, you got to manage CO2 somewhere, and I thought the world wants what we make. And so, there's been a ton of noise from a ton of places on this thing, and I think I've heard every reason in the book why you can't do it. And, very interesting, but we're doing it. And what I believe is we're doing something really important for the future, and we're showing that it can be done here. Other people come and do it now, and, it won't be as hard for the next guy as it was for me. So I say hooray.